Hey, how are you? Okay. We are 9 as of now. I think we can start the session because of time. Okay. Maybe who can give us a recap what we have discussed in the previous lesson? Anyone who is willing to give us like briefing shortly? Is there any volunteer? Venetia, can you try?
Yes, sir.
Can you try, like, give us a small report what we have discussed in the previous lesson?
Yeah, so we talked about hypothyroidism, where there is primary hypothyroidism, where the TSH levels are high, but the gland is non-functional, so the T4 and T3 will be low when you do the blood, when you do the lab test. And then signs and symptoms are weight gain, like intolerance of cold in the extremities, fatigue, and there is even constipation, and this person tends to have a slower metabolism.
Okay, thank you so much. So we have also discussed about the treatment modalities of hypothyroidism. So mostly a replacement therapy is like commonly recommended. Okay, so then maybe there is just like one slide of case studies. Maybe we can you read like for 1 minute, only for 1 minute, this slide, then we discuss together, then we continue hypothyroidism.
So please take it back for a minute.
Okay. Okay, fine. So what is your opinion? What were the major issues from this patient?
There are signs of hypothyroidism.
Okay, such as?
Weight gain.
Mm-hmm.
Constipation, fatigue.
And even fatigue and lethargy is also part of the clinical features of hypothyroidism. Okay, fine. So have you seen this one? She was working too hard and was not eating right, but the symptoms have not improved despite her primary caregiver give her a vitamin with iron supplement. Then you have seen about like the weight, she added like 2.5 kg despite her appetite was not really very good. Her friend gave her citrulline, some citrulline, but she didn't take it. Citrulline is an antidepressant. Then she takes no medication other than formal contraceptive, maybe occasional acetaminophen for headache and polyethylene glycol. Okay. So other lab findings are normal. So have you seen any derangement in the lab parameters? Any deranged lab parameter? How is the serum cholesterol level? 205, huh? Which is slightly elevated, which is very common in hypothyroid individual because the metabolism of cholesterol will be reduced. Then LDL cholesterol level seems like normal. Then if you look at the thyroid stimulating hormone, the level is very is high. So it is between 2.5 and 10. This, what do you call it? Is it mild or severe form of hypothyroidism? What do you call this level of TSH?
I think it's mild.
It is mild because it is less than 10. Huh? The free T4 level is 12.4 picomole per liter. You can see the reference range, so it is slightly elevated. And you can actually even see the body mass index is 25, that is overweight. So do you think this patient is supposed to receive replacement therapy? What do you think? Is he supposed to take replacement therapy with levothyroxine? Any opinion, any idea? Okay, remember
maybe
what
we have. You can start if it's mild.
Uh-huh.
We can but you start... can start with like a slow dose of like maybe 25 micrograms.
Yeah, yes, we can actually start a very slow dose. But remember, there is a lot of controversies about treatment of mild hypothyroidism. But mostly, the expert opinion recommends if cholesterol level is elevated and if they do have any antibodies, like anti-thyroid antibodies, we can actually start. Otherwise, it is just up to the clinician to decide, and the treatment is mostly individualized. So when you look at this patient, it has actually mild condition, but the cholesterol level is slightly elevated. That means the probability of actually having high cholesterol level in the future will be very high if treatment was not recommended. So maybe we can actually start, but very slow dose with monitoring is usually recommended. Okay, then what would you tell the patient regarding the significance of her septum, elevated TSH level, and risk versus benefits of LT4 therapy? What do you tell to the patient? Patient counseling is very, very key. You don't tell anything to the patient. You just give them 25 microgram you take on the daily basis. So don't take egg milk at the same time because of chelation or drug interaction, in short. And it should be given on the empty stomach. So what are you going to give information to the patient? Any opinion? Okelo?
Maybe the ADRs, like the nervousness, heart palpitation, like unexplained weight loss or intolerance to heat, like,
Yes, we need to explain to them the probable ADRs associated with levothyroxine replacement. So that is very, very important. Then apart from that, of course, we need to give proper information about the adherence of the medication, because most of this treatment is lifelong and we need to give clear instruction to the patient. Okay, then today we're going to discuss about the last sessions of thyroid disorder, hyperthyroidism or thyrotoxicosis. So when you say thyrotoxicosis, this is like the severe form of hypothyroidism and the patients are very symptomatic. So we call it thyrotoxicosis. So hypothyroidism or hyperthyroidism refers to the production of excessive amount of thyroid hormone by the thyroid gland. When you say thyrotoxicosis, it is refers to a clinical syndrome associated with prolonged exposure to elevated levels of thyroid hormone, and mostly, as I mentioned before, there is a severe presentation when a patient is having thyrotoxicosis. So under this condition, the TSH level is usually very low, and the 3T4 level is elevated mostly in overt hyperthyroidism. So remember, when you say overt, that means the patient is having the clinical features of hyperthyroidism. So much less common than hypothyroidism. If you remember what we have discussed at the beginning of this session, we have mentioned hyperthyroidism is not as such common, and it's mostly hypothyroidism, which is very common, especially in developing countries, associated with dietary deficiency of this condition. So hyper is very likely, is not as such popular based on epidemiological studies. So when there is excessive thyroid hormone production, it can actually increase metabolism together with overactivity of sympathetic nervous system. That is why the palpitation sweating is very, very common. So this gives rise to the clinical conditions of hypothyroidism. When you look at the causes of hyperthyroidism, we have mentioned some at the beginning of this session, but the Graves' disease was the most common cause of thyrotoxicosis. And we have mentioned before about what is Graves' disease. It is an autoimmune condition that is actually results in excessive production of the hormone by activating the TSH receptor. So this is just an autoimmune condition. Then the antibodies that is produced can actually serve as an agonist to TSH receptor. Then it activates continuously. So it mimics the effect of TSH, then causing cell division, stimulating the thyroid hormone secretion. That is the most important features of Graves' disease. But like other autoimmune condition, there is no like destruction, the effect of, there is no destructive effect of the antibodies produced against, but rather they're actually continuously activating the hormone production. So those stimulatory immunoglobulins are known as the thyroid receptor antibodies. So this is the name of the antibodies that is produced. But remember, very rarely, the antibodies are actually having an elevated effect to the TSH and results in hypothyroidism. But most of the time, when a patient is having Graves' disease, the probability of hyperthyroidism is very high as compared to hypothyroidism. That is why it is one of the most common causes of hyperthyroidism. When you look at even the possibility of inheritance, 90% of the patients are young women, often with a family history of the condition, and there is a possibility of even like congestive ophthalmopathy. It can actually even affect the optic nerve. So it can actually causes like damage of the connective tissues of the retina. So the possibility of ophthalmopathy or inflammation of the eyes are very, very common in this patient population. In fact, that is actually one of the major findings in the diagnosis of Graves' disease. Then apart from that, in pregnancy, remember, the maternal traps can pass, like the maternal antibodies that is produced during this condition, they can actually cross the placenta, then it can actually affect or causes thyrotoxicosis to the neonate. That is the major problem with Graves' disease if it is not treated. So if you can see, by the way, at least one of the following is a diagnosis for Graves' disease. They might have hyperthyroidism, but mostly this patient, they do have exophthalmopathy. Like you have seen how the eyes are actually bulged out. So this is very common. Swelling of the eyelids are very, very common. So when a patient is actually having this feature, most likely they do have Graves' disease. I think this one is the major finding. But dermopathy is also very common. Sometimes antibodies can actually cross-react and cause some kind of this kind of red spot on the skin. We call it dermopathy. And also, it can even cause thickening of the finger and the toes are very common. We call it acropathy. Yeah? But the most common one is for Graves' disease is the exophthalmopathy is very, very, very common. So you'll see like the eyes are actually like protruding, which is very, very common. Another cause of hyperthyroidism is thyroiditis. Remember, when the thyroid is actually inflamed by viral or acute autoimmune attack, then there is a possibility of release of the follicular cells. The follicle cell days will result in the release of preformed thyroid hormone, and this ultimately causes what? Causes hyperthyroidism. So destruction of the follicles of the thyroid gland. Remember, mostly like more than 99% of the hormone is usually binded to the plasma protein. But when there is an attack of that storage form, then there is release of the preformed hormone. And usually there is a possibility of brief hyperthyroidism. So mostly when a patient is having thyroiditis, like an inflammatory condition, there is a brief hyperthyroidism, but later on, the patient will end up having hypothyroidism. That is very, very common in thyroiditis. So when you look at thyroiditis, mostly it is associated with hypothyroidism, but there is a possibility of having mild component because of like release of the preformed hormone. So most often, this period of hypothyroidism in this condition does not lead to clinically apparent thyrotoxicosis. So the condition is not very, very apparent in case of thyroiditis. But the most important thing in terms of cause is the possibility of having thyroid tumor, thyroid cancer, even over replacement of the hormone is a major, major factor. If a patient is actually having a thyroid tumor, then there is a possibility of having excessive production in the hormone. Then thyroid cancer, I already mentioned. Then TSH secreting pituitary tumor. Remember, if there is a tumor in the anterior pituitary that activates the overproduction of TSH, the probability of the patient to have hyperthyroidism is very, very high. Then if you remember from the previous lesson, there is a tumor which is very commonly associated with pregnancy. We call it gestational trophoblastic disease, what we have seen in the previous class. So in GTD, there is actually like the tumor is usually characterized by excessive production of human chorionic gonadotropic hormone. So this HCG is usually an agonist for TSH in the anterior pituitary. And this ultimately increases the production of T3 and T4, which is very common. So when a patient is having this tumor, the probability of having hyperthyroidism is very, very significant. So those are some of the causes of hyperthyroidism, despite the prevalence of this condition, is not very very severe. Then, like that of mild hypothyroidism, even in this condition, the TSH level can be low, but the ferritin T4 level can be normal in mild condition. That is why TSH is like the gold standard assay in the diagnosis of thyroid disorder. But the major problem with this one, it can actually increase cardiovascular morbidity and mortality. That is very, very, very good, and we need to be very cautious. Then apart from that, when a patient is having prolonged subclinical thyroid toxicosis, there is a possibility of actually even a loss of bone mineral density. We call it osteoporosis. So osteoporosis is very common. Remember, when a patient is having high level of thyroid hormone, the effect on the bone is osteoclastic. That means it promotes bone resorption. So the patient will end up having osteoporosis. That is why if a patient is having hyperthyroidism, there is a need of like monitoring of the possibility of bone loss is very, very significant. Mostly we don't give replacement therapy unless they do have very severe condition. But what we usually give is we just give antithyroid medication so that it can actually prevent even the osteoporosis too. As I mentioned, even in hypothyroidism, mild hypothyroidism is controversial, but the treatment is controversial. So it should be considered when the TSH level is very low, and if a patient is having a Graves' disease, and if the mother is actually postmenopausal woman because of the risk of osteoporosis, if the patient is having underlying cardiovascular disease, there is a need of treatment despite the patient is subclinical. Of course, you can use a very, like the lower limit, like the lower, a very small dose can be initiated in this condition. So those are the circumstances we need to consider treatment in subclinical hyperthyroidism status. Then what are the clinical features when a patient is having hyperthyroidism? Remember at the beginning of the session, we mentioned about the clinical features. So this is more of overactivation of the sympathetic nerve system. Like they become nervous, they become very weak, then perspiration is very common and heat intolerance is very common. As a result of sympathetic overactivity, hyperactivity and tremor is very common. Palpitation is very common because of increased appetite, increased metabolism. Appetite is usually increased because of increased catabolism. There is a possibility of weight loss. Mostly weight loss is very, very, very common. Then most of the hyperthyroid patients usually have warm and moist skin, which is very common. But if they do have Graves' disease, ophthalmopathy and dermopathy is very common. But this one is when a patient is having Graves' disease. So those are some of the clinical pictures we need to know. But remember, they are not specific. Then the TSH level is usually low, like TSH less than 0.5. Then the free T4 level is usually elevated, but it can be normal in mild condition. Then remember about one of the radio iodine uptake scan is one of the tests in the diagnosis of thyroid disorder, despite it is not very common. So the uptake is usually very high when a patient is having hyperthyroidism. And apart from that, some of the antibody tests will be positive if a patient is having Graves' disease. So if the patient is positive for those antibodies, we can say the patient will have what? Graves' disease. So those are the major clinical presentation when a patient is having hyperthyroidism. So having said this much about this condition, how do we treat hyperthyroidism? Okay. So maybe can I get or can I receive feedback? How do we treat hyperthyroidism? Anyone who can try?
Maybe you treat the cause.
Okay, like, you treat the cause, huh?
Yeah. If it's a tumor, you remove it, something like that.
Okay, if it is a tumor, of course you remove it. So treating the underlying causes will be one strategy. Okay, thank you. Any other?
Maybe a TSH receptor antagonist.
Okay, we give, by the way, currently we don't have any TSH receptor antagonist at the moment. Okay, but thank you. I don't know, unless it is in clinical trial, so far we don't have any TSH receptor antagonist. Maybe you can even check. But that is maybe like the future strategies in the treatment of hyperthyroidism. Okay, any other person? Any other treatment modalities? Okay, do you remember what we have discussed when we are discussing about the thyroid hormone synthesis? We do have like few class of drugs which are interfering the thyroid hormone synthesis, which is most commonly used in the clinical setting. So anyways, the goal of therapy is relieve the sign and symptoms of the disease. That is very, very important. Then we reduce the hormone production so that we can achieve biochemical euthyroidism. So EU means like maintaining the normal state of the hormone. Then lastly, to prevent the long-term complications of hyperthyroidism. Remember, when a patient is having hyperthyroidism, there are several complications, including risk of heart failure, including the probability of atrial fibrillation or arrhythmia, even the possibility of osteoporosis is actually very high. So the cardiovascular mortality and the risk of osteoporosis is very significant, so that we can prevent the long-term adverse effect of this medication. Okay, I think the video you can watch later. Then, regarding to the treatment of hyperthyroidism, we do have four strategies. But the most common one is the use of thyroamides, which is mostly interfering the thyroid hormone synthesis. But we also use radioactive iodine, not common. They mostly use in when they do have a cancer. And also we do have liquid solution, which is iodine and potassium iodide. I don't know whether you have prepared this formulation in the pharmaceutics lab. Did you manage to formulate liquid solution in pharmaceutics lab? Or not yet?
Not yet.
Okay, and this one is one of like the formulation or one of the extemporaneous preparation that can be done in the lab, which is very simple. So iodine with potassium iodide. So this complex formation, by the role of potassium iodide is just to increase solubility of iodine by forming complexation. So that is the role, so that it can be actually absorbed to the circulation. Then the last resort is surgery. So surgical dissection is like the last resort in the treatment of hyperthyroidism. So I'm going to take you through when are we going to use each treatment modality. So far we do have only those treatment modalities available at the moment. Okay, when you look at treatment of hyperthyroidism in general, there are a number of factors that should be considered when we are choosing the most appropriate form of therapy. But so far there is no general agreement to the specific indication for each form of therapy, and none of them is ideal. All of them are actually associated with short-term and long-term complication. Neither surgery nor radioactive iodine should be given until the patient has been rendered euthyroid due to the risk of the risk of inducing a thyroid crisis. So that one will come later. But so the patient is supposed to be at least in the normal, or euthyroid state before you do surgery. Why? Because the moment you do surgery, by the what will happen? The stored form of thyroid globules, like the thyroid hormone, as I mentioned in the previous session, they stored in the form of globules. So when it is needed by the tissue, this undergo cleavage. We call it proteolysis, so that the hormone can be utilized physiologically. But when you do surgery and radioactive iodine therapy before the patient is euthyroid, what will happen? This destruction can cause dumping of the hormone to the circulation, so the patient will end up having acute thyroid crisis. So that is why, like before surgery, even during the surgical procedure, because of the incision, now this this globule can be destructed, so that the hormone can be released in the circulation, and so that the patient will have a crisis immediately. So because of that reason, like those treatment modalities should not be initiated before the patient thyroid hormone is euthyroid. That is why you just give antithyroid treatment before you do surgery. Then when the patient is euthyroid, now you can do surgery. So this is the general recommendation. So now let me take you back to thyroid hormone synthesis. Remember, when there is actually diet, the iodide will be uptake from the diet. So there is a transporter that actually transport iodide to the thyroid gland. Then after that, the first step will be oxidation, like peroxidase. So it will be oxidized by peroxidase enzyme. Then after that, it forms like organification with tyrosine residue. After that, there is coupling process. So after coupling, there is a formation of what? There is a formation of T3 and T4. Then it is stored in form of thyroglobulin. So when it is needed, it should undergo proteolysis so that it can be used physiologically. Then T4 will be converted to T3 by the tissue, so that it can convert the most physiologically active form of the T3. So when you look at the majority of the drugs we are having in the market, we do have by the thiocyanates and perchlorate, but they are not very common because of toxicities. But they are mainly involved in inhibiting the uptake of iodide. So if they prevent uptake of iodide by inhibiting the transporter, then they can inhibit the other process of the formation of the active hormone T4 and T3. If you look at the iodide, the one I mentioned before, glucose solution is iodide. So this one, it has actually multiple mechanisms of action. It inhibits even proteolysis, the like organification of the iodine molecule. So that is one mechanism. Then the thioamides are mostly inhibiting organification as well as the coupling. So they prevent coupling. Remember, if they don't couple, means the TC4, T4 and T3 will not be formed. So the thioamides, which is commonly used in the market, are mostly inhibiting the conversion or the organification of iodine to iodotyrosine, and also the coupling of monoiodotyrosine and iodotyrosine to form T3 and T4. That is the principal mechanism of thioamides. In fact, you'll discuss in detail more when you are discussing about the pharmacology of antithyroid drugs. Then when you look at the T4 and T3, T4 and T3 can be, or T4 can be converted to T3 by deiodinase enzyme. So some class of drugs such as beta blocker, corticosteroids, and even from thioamides, PTU, I will come later, it actually inhibits the conversion of T4 to T3, so that it reduces the active hormone
in the serum. That is also another principal mechanism. But they, when a patient is having hyperthyroidism, there's a scenario we're going to use a beta blocker, especially to reduce palpitation and even perspiration. But this one is just like blocking the effect of catecholamine. But apart from that, the moment you are giving beta blocker, they can actually inhibit the conversion of T4 to T3, then they can inhibit the production of the active hormone. And apart from that, in hyperthyroidism, we can also give corticosteroids, because corticosteroids, they inhibit the conversion of T4 to T3. Then apart from that, they prevent like the antibodies that is produced against the thyroid gland, so that it can be considered in the management, but not very, very frequent. Have you seen even amiodarone? The principal mechanism how amiodarone causes hypothyroidism is mostly by inhibiting the conversion of T4 to T3, so that it reduces the level of free T4 in the serum. So in a way, this is the general mechanism of action of antithyroid medication. So in brief, but more, we are going to discuss about the clinical aspects of antithyroid medication, like in terms of side effect profile, in terms of dosing, in terms of choice. That is the point of the clinical aspect. So thioamides is a class of drug that contain propylthioacyl, carbimazole, and metimazole. Even personally, I didn't came across carbimazole and metimazole, but PTU is very popular. PTU is the most commonly used antithyroid drug, and most likely you can't miss any community pharmacy. That is my observation in Nairobi. So you can't miss availability of PTU. So this is very, very prevalent antithyroid medication. So in general, as a class, all of them are equally effective pharmacological therapies for thyrotoxicosis. So the use of, or like the selection of this medication is primarily depending on the ADR profile, as well as maybe contraindication of the medication, and I will come later why propylthioacyl is chosen, or why, when do we use propylthioacyl as compared to metimazole. But they are in the same class, and they are actually sulfur-containing drugs available in the market. So generally speaking, thioamides, when you look at the mechanism of action of thioamides, they are mainly inhibiting the synthesis of thyroid hormone. So because they are only inhibiting thyroid hormone synthesis, they cannot interfere the already produced thyroid hormone. Because of this reason, until the store is actually exhausted, the probability of observing maximum effect is very, very minimal. Due to this reason, they do have a slow onset of activity and often requires 3 to 4 weeks for full effect to be seen. So that, like, remember, especially the thyroid hormone, it has longer half-life, so that it can stay in the serum for a long period of time before it undergo catabolism by the liver. So because of this reason, thioamides are very slow onset of action, and you can see we need to administer up to 3 to 4 weeks to see the effect. Then this is mainly because they don't inhibit the release of the preformed thyroid hormone. So maybe let me ask you one question. So when you look at from these drugs, which class of drug will have most probably like fastest onset of action among the list? Which one will have like rapid onset of action? Iodide, thioamide, or beta blockers?
I think beta blockers.
Okay, why?
Because the one in the serum, the thyroid hormone in the serum is the one which is affected. So it's instead.
Okay, exactly. Yes, yeah, so the beta blockers as well as the iodides. Remember, the iodides, even they prevent like proteolysis. That means they reduce the available like active hormone in the serum. So iodides are, and the beta blockers are very rapid onset of action because they're actually inhibiting the release of the hormone into the serum. So if you want to achieve rapid onset of action, PTU, in fact, PTU has actually an effect. PTU normally inhibits the conversion of T4 and T3. It actually even inhibits the conversion of T4, T3. So comparatively, PTU is having rapid onset of action as compared to carbamazole because of the effect. But mostly, iodide is the one which is having rapid onset of action. So if you want to see rapid effect, this one should be given first, yeah, before you start giving. I think that is why PTU is commonly given, because it is actually inhibiting the conventional T4, T2, T3, so that it has comparatively rapid onset of action as compared to carbamazole or metimazole. So anyways, metimazole is active drug, carbamazole is a prodrug, and both of them are available clinically, but I'm not very sure about availability in Kenya market, but PTU is the most widely available thiamide in the market. Okay, then when you look at propyl thiuracil, I've already mentioned about principal mechanism, and I have already mentioned the inhibit organification of iodide and the inhibit the coupling, so that this and this will not form T3 and T4. Then apart from that, it also inhibits the peripheral conversion of T4 to T3. That is why it has rapid onset of action as compared to carbamazole, because of this principal mechanism. Otherwise, another parameter, they are similar. Like mechanistically, both of them inhibit organification and coupling, but PTU inhibits the conversion of T4, T3. That is why it is comparatively having rapid onset of action. Then, when you look at in terms of dosing, 300 to 600 milligram per day, and usually in divided dose is commonly considered. So I think 100 or 50 milligram strength is PTU tablet is the most commonly available strength in the market, but it's usually given 100 milligram TDS, TDS or three times per day. But the maximum dose we can give is 1200, that is the daily dose. Then apart from that, if the mother is actually pregnant, propyl thiuracil is less likely than metimazole to cross the placenta and enter the breast milk. Maybe I don't know about the difference in the chemical structure. Maybe you cross-check the medicinal chemistry aspect, why it is actually having a lower potential to cross, despite they are in the same class. That one you have to check. So generally speaking, propyl thiuracil has less potential to cross the placental barrier. So this is a drug of choice in the treatment of hyperthyroidism in pregnancy as well as lactating mother. Okay, then after the patient become euthyroid, then we have to reduce the dose. So this is a maintenance dose. 100 to 200 milligram daily dose is sufficient. So this is how we are going to give so that we can maintain the euthyroid state for long period of time. Metimazole, still they do have the same mechanism of action, but the beauty of this drug is normally there is no need of like frequent dosing. Usually once daily dose is given, it can cross the placenta, enter in the breast milk. Comparatively, it is not as safe. And even then, because of the ability to cross the placenta, I think studies showed that metimazole has some teratogenic effect to the fetus. Because of this reason, it is not commonly recommended for pregnant mother. Mostly it is administered once by daily, and it's very important as compared to propylthio uracil. Then, as a pharmacist, we need to know adverse effect of the drugs. That is very, very important. So when you look at adverse effect, usually occur during the first 6 weeks of treatment, and minor adverse effects, like which is most common, are rash, arthropathy, and fever. I think the rash is associated with the sulfur. Yeah, like sulfur-containing drugs, the possibility of allergic reaction is mostly very common. Rash, arthropathy, and fever is very common, but the most serious and less common ones are agnalocytosis. This is the major problem with thioamides, especially for PTU, the probability of having agnalocytosis or reduced the neutrophil count is very, very significant, but it is very, very rare. That's why when a patient is actually taking this class of drugs and inhale, if the neutrophil count suddenly declined, I don't trust to the patient is actually having any other condition. It can be the drug that causes the suppression of the bone marrow, and the patient will end up having a low neutrophil count, which is very common, which is the most likely caused by PTU. Even hepatotoxicity and aplastic anemia is also very common. I think those are the kind of things we need to be very cautious about in case if a patient is taking PTU. We have to monitor the neutrophil count, liver function test, even the possibility of aplastic anemia is very common with PTU. That is why in terms of ADR, is PTU is most notorious as compared to metimazole. So agnalocytosis almost always occur within the first 3 months of therapy. This is based on epidemiological studies. So blood count is essential during therapy, especially if the patient develops infection. So if the patient develops infection, we need to be very, very cautious about it, and which is very, very, very important. Then if agnalocytosis occur, what you can do is you discontinue the antithyroid medication immediately, then you administer broad spectrum antibiotics. Remember, if the neutrophil counts are the one, which neutrophils are the white blood cells, they are very important to protect us from having a bacterial infection mostly. So if a patient is having reduced neutrophil count, means the probability of having even very severe systemic infection is very high. That is why broad spectrum antibiotic should be immediately given after discontinuing of propylthio uracil. That is very, very important. So in short, PTU is most commonly used, but very careful about possibility of agnalocytosis. Then another treatment modalities, but not commonly used, is radioactive iodine. This is radiopharmaceutical. Hopefully we'll discuss it about the nuclear chemistry or nuclear radiopharmaceutical in pharmaceutics. You'll discuss it about radiopharmaceutical. So radioactive iodine, I-131, is one of the most commonly used radioactive material in the treatment of hyperthyroidism. Remember, this one is just a capsule, but it contains radioactive iodine, that is iodine 131. So when it is swallowed, what will happen? It can actually concentrate in the thyroid gland. Then it emits radiation. By the way, they are called radiopharmaceutical because they emit alpha, beta, and gamma radiation. But mostly, the radiopharmaceutical that emit beta radiation is mostly visible for treatment. But those who are emitting gamma radiation is mostly for imaging. They can actually show like the internal organs clearly. So these radiopharmaceuticals are mostly emit beta radiation so that it can actually cause significant damage to the gland. That is why the moment you give radioactive iodine, if the patient is not euthyroid, it can actually disturb the thyroglobulin, like storage form of the thyroid hormone, then the hormone can be released immediately so that it can actually increase the risk of what? Sudden thyrotoxicosis. So the destructive effect of radioiodine on thyroid tissue is caused by the beta radiation. So this one generally produces thyroid ablation without surgery. By the way, in terms of efficacy, it is equivalent to thyroidectomy or thyroid surgery. But the major problem is it is actually having a slow onset of action, and most patients are treated initially with beta blocker and anti-thyroid drugs because of the slow onset of action. Yeah, that is something we need to note, but as I mentioned, it is not a common thing. But the major problem with this condition is like after a single dose, 40 to 70% become euthyroid. 6 to 8 weeks later, 80% can be cured from hyperthyroidism. But the major problem is the patient can have permanent hypothyroidism. So there is a possibility of permanent damage to the gland. So the patient will end up having hypothyroidism. That is the major problem with this patient population. So generally, I mentioned about rapidly absorbed from oral administration, then it concentrated in the gland and stored and incorporated into storage of follicle and causes destruction and contraindication, mostly for pregnancy and breastfeeding mother. It is not generally recommended because it can cross the placental barrier and affects the fetal thyroid. So because of this reason, for pregnancy and breastfeeding mother, still PT will be the drug of choice in the management. Are we together? Are we together?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, now the next class of drug we're going to discuss when we're talking about hypothyroidism is the role of Lugo solution. So this Lugo solutions is very simple formulation. It's just iodine with potassium iodide. Potassium iodide is mainly to increase solubility. Okay, we have mentioned about the principal mode of action, but you still do it in pharmacology. But it is mostly inhibiting iodination of tyrosine, as well as it inhibits the thyroid hormone release. This is very, very, very important aspect, especially for rapid onset of action. But the beauty of this drug is mostly it decreases the size and vascularity of the thyroid gland. By the moment you give like Lugo solution for 1 month, like the vascularity of the gland will be significantly reduced. So because it inhibits the release as well as synthesis of the hormone, the onset of action is very, very rapid. Why? It usually inhibits the release of the hormone. Because of that, it has rapid onset of action as compared to the other antithyroid medication. But the major issue is the effect is usually very mild and transient. Then after some time, the thyroid gland can escape from the iodide blockage after several weeks of treatment. So we are not supposed to use Lugo solution for a long period of time because the gland is not responding. So mostly we just give them like a few days before surgery so that it can reduce the size and vascularity of the gland. So it is not useful for long-term therapy because the hormone ceases to respond to the drug after a few weeks of therapy. So the possibility of tolerance is very, very high with Lugo's solution. And mostly, it is recommended for preparation of thyrotoxic patients for surgery, like thyroidectomy, so that it reduces the vascularity. And mostly, it is usually given like 7 to 10 days before the operation to reduce the size and vascularity of the gland. And of course, it has actually rapid onset of action. But the major problem with Lugo solution is, I think from here, the side effects are very minor in most of the cases, but the major problem is the metallic taste in the mouth. that is the major like cause of non-adherence. So even the metallic test in the mouse can last for a long period of time. Yeah. For example, if the patient is actually taking maybe like few ml, might be 5 ml or 5 drops per day after diluting with water. Mostly by the pharmacist will prepare concentrated solution, then the patient is supposed to take at least 5 drops 2 days, 2 times per day, then he or she is supposed to dilute in water. But that metallic test will actually last for some time. That's the major problem with adverse effects of glucose solution. So remember, we cannot give for more than 2 weeks because most of the time it will not respond. And mostly it is useful only for a few duration of treatment. The anion inhibitors are the thiocyanate and perchlorate. Remember, this class of drugs are not common. Why? Because the thiocyanates, they usually block the iodide uptake by the thyroid gland. So they are actually competitive inhibitors of the iodide transporter. That is the main mechanism. But because their effectiveness is unpredictable and the chloride can cause aplastic anemia, they rarely use clinically. I've never seen any thiocyanates and perchlorate. I just mentioned this is maybe another option in the treatment of hyperthyroidism. So lastly, surgery. Remember, surgery can be mostly subtotal thyroidectomy is very, very, very common. If you remove the whole of the gland, now this will be another problem. This will be another problem because the patient will be permanently hypothyroid. So they will just remove some section, that is, we call it subtotal thyroidectomy, is very, very common. So when does the patient is eligible to do surgery? If a patient is having very large goiter and with thyroid malignancies, maybe that is where we are going to consider subtotal thyroidectomy. And also, when a patient is not responding or cannot tolerate other therapies, we can consider what? We can consider surgery. But remember, surgery is like the last resort in the treatment of thyroid disorder. But of course, in a few patients with hypothyroidism, in a few patients with hypothyroidism with massive goiter, and if the swelling or the goiter is affecting the trachea and even the esophagus, now this is when we are going to consider surgery. Otherwise, surgery is not as such common in the management of hypothyroidism, unless the patient is having all those indications. So remember what I mentioned before. The patient must be euthyroid before surgery. If not, what will happen? If not, what will happen? During the surgery, when the follicles are actually undergo damage due to the incision process, now there is a possibility of what? Thyroid crisis can be because the preformed stored form of thyroid hormone can be released in the circulation. So patients often are administered iodide preoperatively to reduce the gland vascularity. That is very important so that you reduce what? Excessive bleeding during surgery. So you just reduce vascularity before surgery. Mostly 2 weeks of glucose solution treatment is mandatory. And postoperative hypothyroidism occurs in 10% of the patients. So that is why we need to even consider thyroxine replacement therapy. But then even after surgery, you need to give like few days or few weeks. That one I will come during the case discussion on Friday. You just give them replacement therapy for a week, for a few weeks. So if the patient is euthyroid, now you discontinue the treatment after surgery. Okay, then the major problem with surgery is the possibility of affecting the thyroid gland, parathyroid gland is very common. If you look at anatomically, like the parathyroid gland is located anteriorly on the top of the thyroid gland. So the and they are very small and tiny. So during surgery, the probability of removal of the parathyroid gland is very, very, very high. In fact, I encountered one incidence in a patient. They did surgery initially, but what the major problem they had, they removed the parathyroid gland by mistake as well during the surgical section. So finally, the patient ended up having actually a tetany. Remember, when a patient is actually, when you remove the gland, parathyroid gland, now the calcium regulation will be disturbed and the patient will have hypocalcemia. So this hypocalcemia is mostly causing tetany. So you will see excessive contraction in a patient when they do have a sudden destruction of the parathyroid gland as a result of surgery. So for that kind of patient, what you can do is you just continuously replace calcium. So this is very, very common mistakes that can happen during surgery. So post-operative administration of calcium and calcitriol may be given and then tapered over 1 to 2 weeks if the patient does not develop any hypoparathyroidism. So after surgery, even there is a scenario where we are going to consider calcium supplement. Then after that, maybe you need to stop if the patient does not have any calcium disorder. So those are the pointers we need to give more attention. And of course, you need to know surgery is the last resort for management of hyperthyroidism. Then let's see about treatment of hyperthyroidism in a special population. Remember, pregnancy may worsen or precipitate thyrotoxicosis. Why pregnancy can worsen thyrotoxicosis? Tony?
Yes, sir.
Why pregnancy can exacerbate thyrotoxicosis?
I think it elevates the thyroid hormone.
It elevates the thyroid hormone, huh? How? How does it elevate?
Not sure, sir.
Okay, any other person? Angela?
I'm not sure.
Okay, remember what we have discussed in pregnancy, yeah? If the mother is pregnant, it is producing more of ACG, yes? So ACG more produced means it is actually serves as a TSH agonist. So it can worsen the condition if the patient is having any underlying disorder. So that is the major problem. So ACG will serve as a TSH agonist by itself. So the patient's already hyperthyroid. So pregnancy in additional increased risk. So fetal and neonatal hyperthyroidism may occur. Untreated maternal thyrotoxicosis can result in increased rate of miscarriage, premature delivery, and low birth weight. So that is why there is a need of treatment of thyroid disorder in pregnant mother for both. So and PTU is considered the treatment of choice in pregnant mother because it's less likely to cross the placental barrier and the possibility of having teratogenic effect like that of metimazole is very unlikely. So for pregnant woman, PTU is the primary drug of choice. In neonates and PDs, a neonate born to mother with Graves' disease will be hyperthyroid at delivery, so we need to give them this is the dose we're supposed to give. Up to 10 milligram per kg per day or metimazole 0.5 to 1 milligram per kg per day may be required up to 12 weak. So there is a probability. Remember, the antibodies can actually cross the placenta and causes hyperthyroidism in the neonates. That is why we're supposed to treat at least for 2 weeks and see if the patient is not having any thyroid disorder. So especially with Graves' mother, his autoimmune condition, the probability is very high. So that is another thing to know. Then there are some additional therapies adjunct treatment to antithyroid therapy. So they are not directly involved in the inhibition of thyroid hormone synthesis, but mostly they're actually involved in symptomatic relief. For example, beta blocker. Beta blocker, they actually inhibit what? Sympathetic overactivity when a patient is having hyperthyroidism, so that they relieve palpitation, relieve tremor, they relieve anxiety, they relieve heat intolerance. That is why they are commonly used additive treatment in the management of hyperthyroidism. So this is the dose, and mostly prothioprazole can be given. But as I mentioned before, beta blocker, they can reduce thyroid hormone synthesis by inhibiting the conversion of T4 to T3. That is the principal, another additional mechanism for the drug. Then, in case if we are not able to use beta blocker, maybe if the patient is asthmatic, if the patient is asthmatic, we are not allowed to use beta blocker. So in case in that condition, we can use the calcium channel blocker, diltiazem. It can control the tachycardia in patients in whom beta blocker is contraindicated. Yeah, so this is another adjunct treatment to antithyroid therapy, and mostly beta blocker is commonly used. Then treatment of thyroid storm. Remember, thyroid storm is known as thyrotoxicosis. This is very life-threatening condition caused by severe thyrotoxicosis. So the patient will have tachycardia, dehydration, delirium, even GI disturbance is very common because of the catecholamine storm as a result of the hormone. So in that condition, what do? We can give IV propranolol so that this is very effective to blunt the sympathetic stimulation. Then we can also use calcium channel blocker, diltiazem, but most importantly, this one, at least they do have rapid onset of action, then we have to give very large dose of prothioprazole. That is the recommendation, 900 to 1200 milligram per day, high dose can be given. Then IV or oral iodide can also be given. Then of course we need to give supportive care, like we give paracetamol to suppress fever, maybe have to give fluid to prevent dehydration because of sympathetic overactivity. So this is how we're treating a very severe form of thyroid disorder. Okay, finally, if a patient is having this condition, of course we need to monitor. The monitoring is similar to hypothyroidism. TSH is the most sensitive. Then we have to check after 4 to 6 weeks, after 6 month initiation. Then we check TFT every 3 to 6 months when the patient is stable. So like for the after initiation, we check every 4 to 6 weeks until they become euthyroid. When they become euthyroid, we can check every 3 to 6 months. That is the recommendation when a patient is having this condition. So finally, can we do this together? Just read for 2 minutes. Can leave it the slides for 2 minutes so that we can do together.
So I think by now we have read, I have already read about the case study, very simple case study. So maybe what was the major problem with the patient first? What are the major problem with the patient? What are the major problem with the patient? Okay, Jerry?
Loss of weight.
Sorry?
Loss of weight.
And there losing is loss of weight. Okay. Oh, yeah. Okay,
and loss also of weight. Talking and always feeling hungry.
Yes, always feeling hungry. Uh-huh. Any other person?
Heartbeat, like increased heartbeat.
Yeah, have you seen even the vital sign from the physical examination side? The pulse rate is like 122 beats per minute, which is like very high. Tachycardic. Okay, good. He's actually feeling anxious, and also the appetite is actually increased. Yes, and those are some of the major findings. As you said, also like anxiety and hungry is also a common finding. Then in the cardiovascular system, you have seen tachycardic, regular rhythm. Okay, good. Then extremities, have you seen the tremors? Huh? So this is actually because of the catecholamine effect. Then on the skin, you will see warm and moist skin. Okay, huh? Then ECG tells there is sinus tachycardia. I hope you remember how we are going to measure the heart rate from the ECG, sinus tachycardia, then the lab parameters, electrolyte and CBC are normal, which is good. Then have you seen the TSH level? It's significantly low. That means the patient is having what? Primary hyperthyroidism. So it is very low. That means it is primary hyperthyroidism. Okay, then what about the free T4 level? Is it high? Free T4 level is like 4.2, which is very high. Then the patient is also positive for thyroid stimulating receptor antibodies. So most likely this patient is having what? Graves' disease, because he's positive for antibodies. And this one is actually confirms mostly Graves' disease. So what therapeutic option exists for this patient? Now you can talk. Huh? What therapeutic options do we have, Riha?
You can give thiamide.
Thiamide is such as?
PTU.
PTU,
the
huh?
Common one.
Okay.
Metimazole and carbamazole.
Okay, huh? Good. So we can initiate. Uh-huh. When we look at the HENT examination, diffuse enlarged thyroid and mild exophthalmos. Have you seen even the patient is having exophthalmos? That is actually even confirming the patient is having a diagnosis of Graves' disease. Okay, so we do have all the options, but we have to start with the pharmacological therapy first before we go to surgery. So what pharmacotherapy would you recommend? I have already said, what if she's pregnant?
What if you were pregnant? Read it. What are we going to give her if she were pregnant? Okay, Noor. Any other person who can try? This is a very simple question. Okay, we can give, okay, 5 fluoroiracil. Sorry, PTU. Hmm? PTU. PTU we can give because it does not cross the placental barrier. Okay, how do you initiate and titrate the therapy? I think this one you recall. How do you titrate and initiate the therapy? Patel? Oh, that means you didn't attend the class, huh? Very well, maybe, yeah? Geoffrey?
Hello, sir.
Yes, I can hear.
Can you repeat the question?
How do you initiate and titrate the therapy for this patient? You have said PTU is like the primary drug for this patient. How do you initiate and titrate the therapy?
I'm not sure, sir.
Okay, fine. If you remember, by the way, we already said even like in the previous slide, we just give them PPU 300 to 600 milligram daily dose. Then after that, when we just titrate, we measure every 4 to 6 weeks, but the maximum we can go is up to what? Up to 1200. If a patient is actually euthyroid, then we're going to actually reduce the dose to 100 to 200 milligram daily dose. So this is how we're going to titrate the dose for this patient. Okay, I think let me stop here because the rest is very, very simple. What would you tell the patient regarding the cause of a pineal septum? So most likely it's just an autoimmune condition that causes her condition because of the positive antibody test and also the mild exophthalmos. Most likely the patient is actually having Graves' disease. And apart from that, she thinks that her mother had some kind of thyroid problem when she was pregnant with her. Maybe that can be even related to Graves' disease because the possibility of inheritance is very, very, very high. And of course, some antibodies can cross and cause what? Causes hyperthyroidism in that person. Okay, that is all. Now, let me receive a question. Any question or any clarification? So this is all about thyroid disorder in brief. There is nothing much about thyroid disorder. Any question?
I have a question.
Okay,
You said before surgery the patient needs to be euthyroid. Why?
Because remember, when you are doing surgical resection, some of the stored thyroid globulin or thyroid hormone can be actually dumped to the circulation and causes like thyrotoxicosis immediately after surgery. Yeah, because when you are doing resection, or that means when you are actually doing resection, means you are damaging the stored form of the thyroid hormone so that can dampen to the circulation and causes a lot of crisis. So the patient should be euthyroid first before we do thyroid surgery.
Okay, thank you.
Yes. Apart from that, not only even your thyroid, even the vascularity should be significantly reduced. Otherwise, there is a lot of bleeding even. That is why iodide should be given like 2 weeks before the surgery. Okay, good observation. Any other question? Okay, fine. So I'm assuming you have learned something, at least how we're managing thyroid condition, like hypothyroidism. So maybe I'm expecting you already have the whole picture of hypothyroid management. So the class of drugs were mentioned. So I'm assuming even you have learned about the mechanism of action of anti-thyroid medication. So like the PTEO, thiamides, then radioactive iodine, the role of surgery, and etc., and the role of even additive treatment such as beta blockers. Okay, fine. So this is all I have for today. So if you don't have any further question, you can leave the meeting. Thank you so much for your attention.